before I get into the background of the 12 tribes of Israel and the information concerning the lost tribes and promised land, I want to go into this book first. And as I always say, I want to throw a little mud in the water. So we're going to read this. It's called With the Latest Scientific Evidence, The Mound Builders by Edgar Cayce's Forgotten Record of an Ancient America by Gregory L. Little, John Van Aken, and Laura Little. I want to show you when this book was published. It was published in 1971 by Edgar Cayce's Readings. I want to take you to page 28, and we're going to drop down here where it says 3000 BC. Now, around 3000 BC, this was the time when the Israelites actually fled from Egypt. It would be actually between the time, from the time of Shem having his children to the time of the Israelites fleeing out of Egypt into the wilderness and migrating their way into the promised land. So there was always Israelites who wanted to do their own thing, but this is what the archaeologists say. We're going to read about this here. Lost tribes of Israel arrive in Eastern and Western America. Lost tribes move to Mexico, then migrate to Ohio. The mound builder culture emerges. Now, the mound builder culture emerges because it's claimed that the mound building started in Egypt, the pyramids. And then that custom and that trade went all over the world after that, because Ham was the one who started the mound building. And those who dwelt in that land, who built and constructed these mounds, were the Israelites and other nations. So as we go down, it says in 3000 BC, the date Cayce gives for the events causing the historical lost tribes of Israel, a portion of the lost tribes arrived by boat at the southernmost portion of the United States. Because remember, the earth did split. The earth was together at one time. It did split. So if it split, imagine people trying to get to that piece of the earth that split, knowing that they could see it drifting. We'll even see it from time to time, move a little bit further out. So it says here, after staying there for a brief time, they moved further south into the area around present-day Mexico City, where they added a new dimension to the culture of pyramid and temple building. This was the use of altars and sacrifices. Not long after that time, experiencing pressure from hostile groups, a migration out of the Yucatan occurred. A portion of the lost tribes and a group of descendants from the earlier Atlanteans, which was the Americas, South Americans, who had migrated to Yucatan to establish a hall of records, moved north into the heart of America. These groups established themselves mainly in Ohio, with smaller settlements in Kentucky and Indiana. There, the mound builder era began. So in the Americas, the Northern Americas, you have mounds, you have pyramids. And when the conquistadors came over, the Spaniards and the French, this was one of the first things they had to destroy, was the mounds or the pyramids. But these mounds had underground tunnels, and a lot of these tunnels went over 100 miles out, if not further, and connected with other tunnels. This might be one of the reasons why Harriet Tubman was able to escape through the tunnels, through the rail, which they call the railroad tunnels, or the mining tunnels. The mound builder culture was originally centered in Ohio. Cayce states that the mounds were built as a replica of the Atlantis, the Yucatan, and Kobe experiences. All right, let's go over here. This is Cayce's chronology of mound builders and the archaeological record. Let's drop down here. According to Cayce, in about 3000 BC, a portion of the lost tribes came to the southernmost portion of America by boats. There it is again. So they knew how to get to and fro with boats at that time. It is assumed that these lost tribes are from the ancient Semitic and Hebrew lands. Casey stated that they remained in America for a relatively short time. These people then moved to the areas around Mexico City where they imposed a new form of ritual on the pyramid builders already present. This ritual was the utilization of sacrificial altars. And if you look in 1 Maccabees chapter 13, I got the verse there, verse 25, you'll see that the Judas Maccabees built 7 pyramids for his father and his brethren. It reads, over time, the use of altars for sacrifices degraded into human sacrifice, facing increased violence and danger from the Belial, the devil, ruling groups who had imposed harsh rule and demanded human sacrifice. A migration northward occurred. A portion of the lost tribes joined with the descendants of the Atlanteans, South Americans, who had been in the Yucatan or since 10,000 BC. So these dates are all inaccurate. This group went north and became the mound builders. According to Casey, the center of their mound culture became Ohio. So yeah, I could agree that there was probably some brothers in those days who had the ingenuity to sail. They were creating ships during those times. So I could believe that's a possibility that brothers and sisters were sailing from parts of Africa over to the Americas at that time. America could have even been closer at that time. So, yeah, here we have it, the mound builders. And there were Shemitic people already dwelling in this land before the migration of the 10 tribes. It should be pointed out that the 3000 BC date Casey gave for the lost tribes does not fit the traditional dating of that event. There's another page, chapter 2, Casey's History of North America in brief. It reads, a few of Casey's reading, especially those describing the lost tribes in America, have been interpreted somewhat differently in this book than in earlier books. While such issues are debatable, there is no doubt that Casey clearly stated that remnants of the lost tribes of Israel came to America. Remnants of the lost tribes of Israel came to America. We were already scattered all over the globe at that time. This is just dealing with the Hebrew language. The point is, this is 3,000 years old. Since the archaeologists keep speaking on the 3,000-year mark, I just wanted to show you what a 3,000-year mark was. So it says here, a 3,000-year-old tablet with God's name affirms biblical timeline. Archaeologist says, this was nutritionheadlines.com, contributor, Friday, March 25th, 2022. All right, let's drop down. Well, not to mention this guy, Michael Faust. Let's drop down. We're going to go to first paragraph. It says, and these are the finds of the archaeologists right here. There's inscriptions on this, and it's in Hebrew text. All right. Here it says, a new discovery from Israel involving an ancient tablet could be one of the most significant archaeological finds in modern history, not only affirming the biblical text, but supporting a traditional conservative understanding of the Old Testament timeline. All right, because we want to find out what that 3,000-year timeline was and when these mound builders actually started to build mounds over in America. It says, the discovery announced Thursday by Scott Stripling of the Archaeological Studies Institute at the Bible Seminary in Katy, Texas, involves a folded lead tablet about 2 centimeters by centimeters in size with 40 letters of Hebrew inscription that apparently references events mentioned in Deuteronomy 27, verse 15 through 26, and Joshua chapter 8, verse 30 at Mount Ebal. There,
the Israelites learn they will be cursed if they disobey the Most High. The tablet, which mentions God's name twice, was discovered at the site of Mount Ebal. More significantly, though, the lead tablet text is centuries older than any known Hebrew inscription from ancient Israel. Stripling's organization says, a lab in Prague scanned the tablet. The text reads, curse, 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 curse by God, Yahweh. You will die, curse, curse, you will surely die, curse by Yahweh, curse, curse, curse. Man, I know if I saw that, I'd be afraid, wouldn't you? Stripling said, and this was when you read Deuteronomy chapter 27, it talks about the tribes. They split up, some tribes blessed, and some tribes they had to curse to let Israel know where they stood. And this is where you get Deuteronomy 28. Stripling said at a press conference of the discovery, on a scale of 1 to 10, this is a 10. It doesn't get any better or bigger than this. If the biblical text were true, this is what you would anticipate finding. And indeed, it is what we found. Stripling said the tablet dates to the late Bronze period, which ran from 3300 BC to 1200 BC. That means it would be roughly 3,000 years old. So here it is. All right. So this is what happened 3,000 years ago. Did some Israelites flee? It's a possibility. Some probably fled. And then you have to, you really plan into it. You're really putting a lot of assumption into it. But just think about a people who are out in the wilderness who get fed up. Everybody's not going to stay together. It says here, secular critics of a traditional dating of the Old Testament often have placed the time of the Exodus from Egypt and the conquest of Canaan at a much later date, and thus calling into question the truthfulness of Scripture. These critics argue that the Pentateuch, which is a Bible, could not have been written by Moses, the Torah too, as claimed by the Bible, because the Hebrew alphabet did not exist when he was alive. How can you make that assumption? Moses was fluent in Egyptian, but he was not fluent in Hebrew. So you had other brothers and sisters who did speak Hebrew and possibly wrote Hebrew because they were in Egypt. They had learned a language or a written language of how the Egyptians kept records. You don't think that they would possibly keep records the same way? So yes, we were probably influenced by the written language of Egyptian language to write down our Hebrew language. It's probably where it first began. So yes, I would say that we had a written language. Because the Hebrew alphabet did not exist when he was alive, the tablet's text, though, would seem to support a Moses authorship. And like I said, you had the Levites who had been there for years in Egypt. You had the other brothers. You just can't look over that. You had intelligent people in Egypt. Here it is here. The discovery, Stripling said, affirms the biblical text. One can no longer argue with a straight face that the biblical text was not written until the Persian period. This is all assumption. 559 BC to 331 BC. Or the Hellenistic period, 323 BC to 30 BC, as many higher critics have done, when here we do clearly have the ability to write the entire text at a much, much earlier date. This tips the scale in favor of an earlier date and does not help the arguments of those who favor a later date. A peer review paper on the tablet will be released in the coming months, Stripling said. Gershon Galal of Haifa University said, the discovery's significance could not be overstated. This is a text you find only every 1,000 years. Galileo told the times of Israel. Of course, you had to find things to write it on. They used stone. All right, papyrus came a little later. The newspaper said it, the papyrus was done in Egypt as well. The newspaper said it may be one of the greatest archaeological discoveries ever. It would be the first attested use of the name of God in the land of Israel and would set the clock back on proven Israelite literacy by several centuries. showing that the Israelites were literate. Of course they were. When they entered the Holy Land, they knew math. They were building pyramids. So if they knew math, why wouldn't they have a written language? Building pyramids and building temples and houses. Showing that the Israelites were literate when they entered the Holy Land and therefore could have written the Bible as some of the events it documents took place, the newspaper said. There's the spill of the 3,000-year period. When it comes to the Pangaea epidemic of the earth splitting, it just didn't happen like in one day. It was a gradual effect for the earth to split during the time of Peleg in Genesis. What is that, in chapter 10? Yeah, during the times of Peleg, the land masses and the people split.
This book is called Modern Times and the Living Past by Olson. This was copyrighted 1921 by the American Book Company. I just want to show you something in here just so you could just meditate on something for a minute. Okay, I want to start here on page 44. All I want is this right here. This was nearly 2,500 years ago. For thousands of years, from the earliest dawn of history, the Hamitic and Semitic peoples have been the leaders of human progress. Now, listen and read closely. But from that day to the present, the Indo-European branch of the Caucasian race has been master of the civilization of the world. So we know Caucasians to be what? European white men and women. Up here is talking about Hamitic Semitic people who are the leaders of human progress. Why aren't they putting Hamitic and Semitic as Caucasian? Because these were dark nations, Ham and Semitic. All right, so I just wanted to show you that just so you could think a little bit that these nations of Ham and Shem are dark nations. Now, getting into the Americas, we're going to go into another book. And this is just to put something on your mind. Origins of the American Indians by Lee E. Huddleston. European Concepts, 1492 to 1729. This book was copyrighted in 1967 by Lee Eldridge Huddleston. We're going to start on page 85, and we're going to drop down to neither at the bottom, last paragraph. Neither Torquemada nor Calancha could accept the authenticity of the Ten Lost Tribes theory. Yet the anonymous author of Isagog of 1711 accepted the story of Esdras to the extent of calling America Arsareth throughout his manuscript. He traced the tribes to Arsareth through Tartary, which is Europe, and settled them in America north of the Isthmus of Tehantepec, 1935-54/60. Here's the point. Carthaginians and possibly Egyptians produced the civilizations of yes, you got to clear your eyes. Guatemala. Carthaginians and Egyptians, dark nations, Hamitic nations, produced the civilizations of Guatemala. Now that's right below Mexico. And it said that the mound builders moved upward into Mexico and then into North America. Here's another thing to note. This is in Judea Trembles Under Rome by Rudolph Windsor. What I like in this book is that he puts a map of the Temple of Jerusalem from the days of King David in his book. And as you can see, it says, the chambers and courts of the temple complex rebuilt during the reign of Herod the Great, 20 BC, c. 10 BC. All right. Now, if you look at this temple, it says the Holy of Holies, the Holy Place, the porch, and then everything is numbered, okay? Ramps, they have the priest court, Israelite court, women's court, okay? These little numbers right here, that's like salt. I mean, it has a breakdown what all this stuff is. But these are the temples. 38. Where's 38? 38. Here's 38 right here. Chamber of Lepers. So all these little small places where the soldiers were, places of salt for the sacrifices, and you had the gates to the Temple Mount, you had the 12 steps, you know, you had different things for different stuff. Chamber of Washers, you know, they had to wash after the sacrifice. You had the chamber of, where is it at? 41. Right here, you had the chamber of animal skins. Okay, you had all these different chambers and offices for soldiers or sick people or for the priest. Okay, now I want to show you something that will make you think a little bit. This is in a book called Aztecs and the Mayas. Complete Illustrative Aztec and Mayas. Now, this is page 430. It says, center of the world, Tenochtitlan. I may not be pronouncing it right. Tenochtitlan. Sounds like chitlins. All right, so if you go down, it says the temple grounds. They had almost the same setup. They had the house of priests, right? They had the temple of Quasicoro, which is where the king would go. They had the ball court. They had the templo mayor. This is where the soldiers went. The unidentified temple, this was the temple of the Holy of Holies. It's almost set up just like the temple in Jerusalem. The sacrificial place where they did sacrifices and then their little chambers. But the Israelites didn't have any influence over this. That's what people say. The influence was there. There's a lot of resemblances between the Israelites and the people of Americas. This is called the Bass Library, Biblical Archaeology Society Online Archives. And as we look down at this one, and I just want to show you this because there is inscriptions of Hebrew in America that archaeologists found. This is called Biblical Archaeology Review 1904, July, August 1993. This is called the Bat Creek Inscription. A lot of us have already heard of this, but this is just so you could put two and two together with the mound builders. Again, it's called the Bat Creek Inscription. And they're saying, did Judean refugees escape to Tennessee? By J. Hudson McAuliffe. Right? This is the Bat Creek Inscription. This is in Hebrew. They were, the archaeologist was reading this thing backwards for years, and then a Jewish scholar came and saw this thing and flipped it around and said, hey, this is Hebrew writing. And they figured out that this was actually a Hebrew inscription. And then as we read here, let's read this. It says, at the beginning of the first Jewish revolt against Rome, 66 to 73 or 74 AD, those dates are always combobulated. They can never get the exact dates.
The inhabitants of Caesarea massacred the Jews who resided in their city, says the first century Jewish historian Flavius Josephus. Within 1 hour, more than 20,000 were slaughtered, and Caesarea was completely emptied of Jews. Is it possible that a few of these Caesarea Jews escaped by sea from this famous port city and eventually ended up in Tennessee? Now, you know, the chief of Tennessee Native Americans, his name was Chief Tanasi, which is also a Hebrew name. Let's read here. In 68 AD, the Jews of Joppa, finding themselves cut off from the country, which had passed into the enemy's hands, built themselves a fleet of piratical ships and made raids on the traffic in the eastern Mediterranean. When the Roman infantry and cavalry attacked Joppa, these people took refuge in their ships, just out of range of the Romans' weapons. But Agel accomplished what the Romans had failed to do by dashing the fleet against the rocky shore, killing 4,200 Jews. Although Josephus implies that none survived, he notes that the fleet attempted to make it to the open sea. Thus, we may legitimately wonder whether any of these ships escaped, and if so, where they could have gone. So, this is the narrative behind it. And as you can see, this Josephus, this historian, also recognized that there was the evacuation of Jews who tried to leave by the sea. So never could underestimate that. The Most High always leaves a few alive. It's just the way it is. There's always a few got to tell the story. Just like we read about the Black Wall Street. It's always a few that are left alive. So this is going not so much during the time of 3000 BC, but this is more so during the time of the Roman persecution of the Jews in 70 AD and up. So this is another phase of when the Israelites came to the America. So there's several different waves of Israelites fleeing and maybe even getting shipwrecked. When we read about those in the Mound Builders coming to the Americas, they never came by one ship. There was always a fleet of ships that sailed through the sea. Just in case they needed help, they needed a ship that carried just the food, where the other ship carried something else. It was never, you know, a lot of us got in our minds just one ship sailing. No, there's always a bunch of ships sailing together for help, just in case they need extra help, tools, whatnot, to get somewhere. And this is what we read about in 2 Ezra chapter 13. It wasn't just one ship. There was many ships that came to the Americas. All right. And like I said, I just wanted to go over this because I wanted to throw some mud in the water just to let you brothers and sisters know that it's just not 2 Ezra chapter 13 where Israelites came to the Americas. We were already here hundreds and hundreds of years before that, or some of us came after that. Okay. If you talk to those explorers in those days, they'd be like, well, he fell on the other side of the ocean. He fell off the side of the earth. Where did he fall? He went to America. If he fell off the side of the earth, you know, they ended up in the Americas, a lost land. And so with that, I'm going to end this video and we're going to go into the 2 Ezra chapter 13 on the next video to show you who those enemies or who those sorcerers were. All right.